So now I'm going to introduce Martin McAleese, Jackie McDonald, and Sean Murray to take the next step. But first, Martin.
Thank you, Bob, and good afternoon, everyone. I was born in Belfast, my native city. I grew up there, and I lived there through the early part of the conflict, which we refer to as the Troubles in Ireland. And I can assure you that it was nothing short of a nightmare. And I think that the video you've just seen captures the real horror, the viciousness and the violence, the grief and the tears of that conflict. And I think also the video demonstrates how dehumanizing the conflict was, on a par, sadly, I have to say, with any conflict in our world today. You've heard two historians from Northern Ireland describe the historical background to the beginning of the conflict in 1969 from two very, very different and diverging perspectives, one from a unionist perspective, one from a nationalist perspective. Centuries of history, some go back as far as 800 years, created the environment for 30 terrible and bloody years during which 3,500 people were killed, countless thousands maimed, badly injured, many, many more left with psychological scars and emotional pain that they will carry with them to the day they die. It wasn't a conventional war. Neighbor against neighbor, neighbor killed neighbor, worker killed worker. And of course, there was widespread property damage and destruction to the tune of well in excess of hundreds of millions of pounds. And just one example of the mayhem of that period is the fact that the Europa Hotel in the center of Belfast, very famous hotel, was famous for being the most bombed hotel in the world during that period. Then in the 1990s, we had the ceasefires and an acceptance that the war could not be won by either side, nor could it be lost by either side. So enough people simply decided that enough was enough. They were tired, they were weary, and many of the protagonists were getting old. And of course, the alternative to some kind of peaceful accommodation was to accept a position of stalemate with ongoing violence in perpetuity, and this was just not acceptable. Then political activity began to emerge, took control, and an agreement for a peaceful way forward was achieved through the signing of the Good Friday Agreement, which signaled the end of violence and a new beginning for Northern Ireland. Now, it has to be said that the process leading to the agreement was long, it was difficult, tortuous, frustrating. The talks collapsed, they resumed again. There were walkouts, walkbacks, three steps forwards, two steps back, and sometimes two steps forward and three steps back. But the agreement was eventually signed against all the odds. Now, this agreement resulted in a mandatory or forced coalition government between very much opposing political parties. Now, as you all know, politics is difficult. Voluntary coalitions can be extremely difficult. So can you imagine just how difficult a mandatory or forced coalition can be? And I think we're seeing some of those difficulties at the moment being experienced in Northern Ireland. Although mandatory coalition is far, far from perfect, it stopped the killing, and that is what is important. So what I've just said is by way of an introduction, by way of background. So what happens next now after this plenary? Well, the members of the panel who have been introduced to you will join about 30 selected delegates from conflict zones around the world for a breakout session. And the main business of this breakout session will involve Jackie McDonald and Sean Murray, both of whom appeared briefly on the video. Now, just to remind you, Jackie is a former loyalist paramilitary prisoner, currently working as a community activist in Belfast, in Northern Ireland. Now, his political ambition is to maintain the constitutional link between Northern Ireland and the United Kingdom. Sean is a leading Republican from Belfast. He is a former IRA, Irish Republican Army prisoner. He is now a senior member of Sinn Féin an all-Ireland political party whose constitutional ambition is to bring about a united Ireland. So, both men differ fundamentally in their political ambitions, and during the conflict, they fought on opposite sides, effectively against each other. And during the breakout session this afternoon, both men will tell the story of their personal journey through the conflict, from the time they became activists up to the end of the conflict. These men come from the extremes of nationalism and unionism. They have been involved in paramilitary activity and paramilitary organizations. They are living proof of the dynamics of the peace process and the challenges involved. And their stories will focus on the personal impact of their involvement in the conflict on their lives, relationships with family and friends, on their ambitions, lost opportunities, on any regrets. Could things have been done differently with the benefit of hindsight? Now, what I'm going to do now is to put a number of questions to each of them to give all of you a flavor, a sense of what will be discussed this afternoon. So my first question is, why did you, in the early part of the conflict, join a paramilitary organization and become an activist? Jackie?
Well, Martin, I joined the Ulster Defence Association in 1972, which you would be aware was the most violent year of the Troubles, following on from the introduction of internment in 1971 and the Republicans' movement response to that day, or events of that day. There was over 500 people killed in 1972. 2,000 bombings, 1972. The year began with Bloody Sunday.
What was Bloody Sunday, Jackie, just to...
Where the paratroops...
The British paratroopers.
The British paratroops opened fire on a crowd of nationalists. Now, there's obviously conflicting stories and there's different ways of looking at it, but there was 13 people killed that day. And you can imagine the reaction that would have brought about from the Republican movement, the nationalist community. 1972, the IRA increased their bombing campaign. Stormont was shut down. Direct rule was reintroduced, which was seen as a major threat to unionism and loyalism. The IRA introduced car bombing. And on the day that probably affected me for the rest of my life, which was Bloody Friday.
And Bloody Friday was?
Where the IRA exploded 23 bombs in just over an hour in Belfast, killing 9 people and maiming and seriously injuring many, many more.
Okay, so you joined the organization, Jackie, and what were the objectives in your mind as a result of joining the organization?
Well,
we
had seen things develop, Martin, over the years, but when that happened on Bloody Friday, that it was time, that was enough. And it was closely followed by 2 car bombs in Clody, which was a quiet village in County Londonderry.
Yes.
Where another 9 people were killed, and no warning bombs. And people like myself, who were just ordinary working guys with families, decided enough was enough. Somebody's going to have to stand up these people.
Yes, so you joined effectively to defend the union against what you saw as the threat from the IRA.
Defend our people, defend the union. Yep.
Okay. Sean, I can put the same question to you. Why did you, in the early part of the conflict, join a paramilitary organization and become an activist? I understand that you joined at the age of 16.
Well, Tom, in his presentation, has outlined the nature of the state under which I grew up. I was highly conscious of that. A state which didn't recognise my sense of Irish identity, a state which conferred second-class citizenship upon me and others from my tradition. So I was highly conscious of that growing up. But things came to a head at the outset of the latest phase of the conflict, because Tom has outlined that, you know, there's been resistance and struggle over a number of centuries in relation to British interference in Ireland, which was resented deeply by nationalists and Republicans. And I remember at the outset standing, watching in total disbelief at the age of 16, as rows of houses in the community which I grew up in were burnt to the ground by an invading army of extreme loyalists. Now, these were neighbours of mine. I grew up with them. I knew every one of them. A friend of mine who lived in the area was shot dead. So overnight, basically, my priorities in life changed. From I had my career laid out in front of me, I was going to university in a couple of years' time, etc., to how can I best defend myself, my family, and my community. So when I looked around for direction and leadership, the only people who provided that direction and leadership were the Republican movement. And that led me to join the ranks of militant Republicanism back in 1969 at the age
of
16.
And the purpose of that was to defend your community and to work towards a united Ireland, ultimately.
Well, initially the priority was defence. Yes. How can I best provide that means of defence? And then obviously to achieve a breakdown of the political regime that entrapped nationalists within the six-county Orange State, as we perceived it then, and to establish reunification of the country.
Okay. My second question is, and I'll put it to you, Jackie, first. What made you change your mind about the effectiveness of violence and try a different, an alternative, or a more peaceful way?
Well, going to prison. Prison gives you time to reflect, Martin.
Yes.
And when I went to prison in 1989, after 17 years of murder and mayhem, I was reunited with some good friends of mine who had killed people, who had planted bombs and were serving long prison sentences. And with due to conversations with them and the way their lives had changed, many had their wives had left them, their partners had left them, they were estranged from their families. Many were having a difficult time and had achieved nothing. And I thought about my family growing up, and I thought about other friends who were going to probably end up in prison as well if something wasn't done about it. And we knew when we were in the prison that the Republicans were having negotiations and they were talking about ceasefires, possibly early releases for prisoners. So we knew that was bound to affect loyalism as well. There was an opportunity here to create the environment for people to sit down and talk. The paramilitaries could create the environment for politicians to sit down and talk, but the paramilitaries had to stop the killing first.
Okay. And thank you, Jackie. Sean, can I put that same question to you? What made you change your mind about the effectiveness of violence and move towards trying to identify a different or alternative way?
I think after 25 years of conflict, the realization came home that we were in a sort of position of military stalemate. Republicans could not defeat the British Army and police, and in turn, the British Army and police could not defeat republicanism. So I think the genesis of the peace process lay in the quest to attempt to develop an alternative. Was there a peaceful and democratic way of achieving republican objectives? We had a lot of engagement. The Hume-Adams Initiative, exactly, provided a platform for that. And Republicans had to be convinced, because obviously, given the background that we grew up in, our generation, because a whole generation at that time were radicalized in relation to the nature of the state and the need for major political change and development of a process to achieve united Ireland. So how could we achieve that through peaceful and democratic means? And the genesis lay in what you referred to earlier. The Good Friday Agreement was provided the political architecture and level playing field for Republicans for the first time ever, and the potential to develop a policing and criminal justice dispensation, which all traditions could sign up to for the first time in the context of the six counties.
Would you say that violence can ever achieve a political objective?
Well, unfortunately, violence is necessary at particular times, and I say that from a Republican perspective. If only we could have achieved our objectives at the start. As I said earlier, when we look around for direction and leadership in 1969, there was no political project which would have delivered our objectives at that time.
Okay, I'm just going to put one question finally to each of you. And my question to you, Jackie, is have you any regrets about your active involvement in the conflict?
Well, I think everybody that was involved in the conflict, Martin, has regrets because things could have been done a different way. But certainly I regret losing so many close friends I regret the way it affected their lives, the way it affected our community throughout the conflict. And it wouldn't be fair to say that I just regret what happened to my friends and my people without saying I regret what happened and what suffering was caused to all the people.
Yes. And Sean, just my final question to you is that you've seen a lot of changes contrasting between when you were involved in the conflict and your life now in a much more peaceful environment. Can you give us one example of what that change might look like?
Well, in any process of peace building, I think it's very important to develop relationships. And relationships are developed at different levels, at the organizational level, and I think most importantly, at a personal level. Yeah. And you have to make peace with your enemies, not with your friends. You can't make peace just by talking or dialogue with friends. You have to dialogue, you have to engage, you have to empathize to a certain extent with your enemy in order to ascertain what are their political needs and requirements for the achieving accommodation. And I think an illustration of that is the personal relationship that has developed between Jackie and myself. 30, 40 years ago, at the head of the conflict, Jackie McDonald would have been a name to me, an intelligence montage, a photograph. We knew of each other. We didn't know each other. I think it's fairly correct to say if the opportunity had existed during that conflict, we probably would have tried to kill each other.
Yes.
So you move from that position to where we did meet up. We did partake in a number of conflict resolution projects, a number of reconciliation projects, which wasn't easy. It was difficult. It was very challenging. But most important of all, it was necessary. Because I keep emphasizing, you have to engage with what you perceive to be your enemy in order to build peace in any conflict situation around the world, etc. And you had a situation whereby yesterday, when I was asked to come to the event, I phoned Jackie, and I says to Jackie, are you coming down to the event? Is there any chance of getting a lift down to Dublin with you? So I think that really emphasizes.
We
pardon?
Tell us where he lifted you from.
Well, he lifted me from the City Hall. So he says, before we go, let's come into the Sinn Féin office and I'll get you a cup of tea. So I had a cup of tea in the Sinn Féin office and he says, the car's parked in the car park. I gets into the back of the car, Jackie had his driver with him. He locked the doors. The hearse of my neck went up at the back. He says, we've got you now.
You can see that we could go on here for a long time. And in fact, we will tease out a lot more this afternoon at the breakout session. But could I ask you to give Jackie and Sean a big round of applause just for their openness and honesty? And I think you know that those of you who are going to the breakout session this afternoon will be very, very privileged to be part of a very unique and a very open and a very honest discussion. Now, I'm going to finish up very quickly here now because in addition to Jackie and Sean's personal stories, we hope to discuss the Good Friday Agreement, that agreement that signaled the end of violence and the beginning, a new beginning for Northern Ireland. We'll discuss the circumstances leading up to it, the difficulties in reaching the agreement, the features of the agreement, the challenges of implementation and the outstanding issues arising from the agreement that so far remain unresolved. And I think it's important just to emphasize that 6 years on from the signing of that agreement, it still has not been fully implemented. And there are reasons for this, and Megan will help us this afternoon to analyze some of those reasons. So, that's what's going to happen this afternoon at the breakout session. At the end of that session, the delegates will split up into small groups to try to identify some lessons that they have learned from the experience. We will come back here tomorrow morning early, and the delegates will report back to you on what their experiences, what they have learned, and maybe on their views as to what may be transferable to the conflict in their own home countries. And that discussion will be moderated by Megan O'Sullivan here, who is familiar with the dynamics of many conflict areas around the world. So we'll see you tomorrow morning, and thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Martin, Sean, Jackie, from all of us in the global, the One Young World family, we're in awe at your courage. I'm sure that there are lessons that all of you have that you'll pass on to these delegates from these terrible conflicts. Someday, somewhere, somehow, these delegates will repay your courage because they will find a way to get through where they are. We commend these delegates into your hands to do the work that needs to be done, and we thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Jackie.
Powerful lessons for everybody, but in particular for the Ukraine and Russia, for Palestine and Israel, for all the conflict regions around the world.